Former Secretary of State and former Joint Chiefs Chairman, General Colin Powell. General, thanks so much for joining us. We really appreciate it. Let's start right now with the extraordinary comments this week from several top former military officials, including former Secretary and General Jim Mattis, condemning President Trump's actions against protesters, his desire to have 10,000 active U.S. military in the streets of this nation. The president's former chief of staff, General Kelly, said he agreed with Mattis. Retired General John Allen says the president's threat to deploy U.S. military against American citizens, quote, may well signal the beginning of the end of the American experiment. Take a listen to what Allen told me Thursday.
I never believed that the Constitution was under threat until recently. And I have concerns about that. We should all be very attentive right now to how the rule of law is being administered in this country.
What's your response to what's been going on the last week, General?
Well, first, thanks very much, Jake. I'm very happy with what General Allen said and all the other generals, admirals are saying, and diplomats are saying. We have a Constitution. And we have to follow the Constitution. And the president has drifted away from it. I'm so proud of what these generals and admirals have done and others have done. But you know, I didn't write a letter because I made my point with respect to Trump's performance some 4 years ago when he was running for office. And when I heard some of the things he was saying, it made it clear that I could not possibly vote for this individual. The first thing that troubled me is the whole birthers movement. And birthers movement had it to do with the fact that the president of the United States, or President Obama, was a black man. That was part of it. And then I was deeply troubled by the way in which he was going around insulting everybody, insulting Gold Star mothers, insulting John McCain, insulting immigrants, and I'm the son of immigrants, insulting anybody who dared to speak against him. And that is dangerous for our democracy. It's dangerous for our country. And I think what we're seeing now, the most massive protest movement I have ever seen in my life, I think this suggests that the country is getting wise to this and we're not going to put up with it anymore.
And former Defense Secretary General Mattis said, quote, Donald Trump is the first president in my lifetime who does not try to unite the American people, does not even pretend to try. Instead, he tries to divide us. It sounds like you agree with that.
You have to agree with it. I mean, look at what he has done to divide us. Forget immigrants. Let's put up a fence in Mexico. Forget this. Let's do this. He is insulting us throughout the world. He is being offensive to our allies. He is not taking into account what our foreign policy is and how it's being affected by his actions. So, yes, I agree with General Allen. I agree with all of my former colleagues. And remember, I've been out of the military now for 25 years. And so I'm watching them closely because they all were junior officers when I left. And I'm proud of what they're doing. I'm proud that they were willing to take the risk of speaking honesty and speaking truth to those who are not speaking truth.
We've seen tens of thousands of protesters taking to the streets this week in opposition to racial injustice and police brutality. Yeah. What's been your personal reaction to this moment? Do you think that the country is in something of a turning point?
We are in turning points. I mean, the Republican Party, the president, thought they were sort of immune. They can go say anything they wanted. And even more troubling, the Congress would just sit there and not in any way resist what the president's doing. And the one word I have to use with respect to what he's been doing for the last several years is a word I would never have used before. I never would have used with any of the four presidents I've worked for. He lies. He lies about things. And he gets away with it because people will not hold him accountable. And so while we're watching him, we need to watch our Congress. I watched the senators heading into the chamber the other day after all this broke, with a reporter saying, what do you have to say? What do you have to say? They had nothing to say. They would not react. And so we're not a country of just a president. We have a Congress. We have a Supreme Court. But most of all, we have the people of the United States, the ones who vote, the ones who vote him in and the ones who vote him out. I couldn't vote for him in 96, and I certainly cannot in any way support President Trump this year.
So, yeah, I know you didn't vote for him in 2016. I assume, based on the fact that you approved Joe Biden when then Senator Obama picked him to be his running mate in 2008, I assume you're going to be voting for Joe Biden?
I'm very close to Joe Biden on a social matter and on a political matter. I've worked with him for 35, 40 years, and he is now the candidate, and I will be voting for him.
Let me ask you, during the Rodney King riots in 1992, you counseled then-President George H.W. Bush on a speech he was about to give. You wrote about this very movingly in your book. You wrote, quote, "I read it with dismay." This is the first copy of the speech. "I thought the tone was all wrong. Yes, the rioting was criminal and law and order had to be restored, but the violence had not incubated in isolation. It had deep social roots. The speech, as it stood, recognized only the former and ignored the latter. Do the law and order bit," you said, "but there's language here that's only going to fan the flames. Turn down the heat," I suggested. "Get some reconciliation into the president's message." And President George H.W. Bush did take your advice back in 1992. He talked about how he was disappointed that the cops who beat Rodney King had been acquitted, and on and on. President Trump has been emphasizing law and order. Do you think that he is talking enough about reconciliation and empathy and what the people in the streets are calling for in his message in any way?
No, he is not in any way that I recognize. He always is shooting toward his base. I remember the Bush conversation very, very vividly, because at the same time, we had to bring law and order back into the streets. And we worked with the state of California, where it happened in Los Angeles, the riots. And the president called me and said, "We may have to do something." I said, "Mr. President, go to the governor. The governor has the National Guard. If the National Guard can't do it, then you come back to me with a decision and we will send in federal troops." And we did. And we brought things under control rather quickly. But the president always followed the law, followed the Constitution, worked with the community, and we brought stability finally. It was a bad scene, but we got over it rather quickly.
Are you willing to campaign for Joe Biden for president?
Well, I haven't been asked, and I don't think I will be. Campaigning is not my strong suit, and I'll be speaking for him, but I don't plan to make campaign trips.
We should note that in addition to the role that you have assumed in American society, you also came in third in the Electoral College in 2016. Because some rogue electors voted for you. So you're actually the third place finisher in 2016, even though you didn't even campaign in any way then.
That's true. I had to read it in a newspaper, and I called my wife. Can this be so? And with three electors in the state of Washington, and it was amusing. And I have clipped out the article, and I've clipped out the instructions that the House of Representatives put on there in their census. And it's now in my library at the National War College. So it was charming. The president kind of misrepresents what the final count was. I got three. I beat everybody else behind me. And it was amusing, but that's all there was to it. But three electors felt that they had the authority to change what they were planning to do. I think they've been fined for it. But it's a symbol of the kind of system we have, a democratic system that our fathers thought through rather carefully and thoughtfully, and now we'll see how it works this year. I think this year is going to be a different kind of year. We have done things that have offended just about everybody in the world. Our friends are distraught with us. We are down on NATO. We are cutting more troops out of Germany. We've done away with our contributions to the World Health Organization. We're not that happy with the United Nations. And just about everywhere you go, you will find this kind of disdain for American foreign policy that is not in our interest. And we have to get on top of this. We have to start acting seriously. How can you say that we're going to take troops out of Germany, but we're also thinking of putting more in, and we're going to create a new headquarters in Germany that was the headquarters I commanded 25 years ago? We've got to make up our mind of what we're doing, but it seems to all come out of the White House without consultation with our Joint Chiefs of Staff. This is not the way this system is supposed to work. And until the president realizes that he needs to understand the Constitution, understand the restraints on him and his authority, and talk openly with his military authorities about what is the right thing to do, and not fire them when he doesn't get the answer he likes.